We've seen the prices of the crypto complex explode, you know, since the beginning of the year. They've come down a bit, maybe even a little more than a bit, you know, 50%+ for a lot of them. But before I ask you about the price action, can you just sort of comment on your general outlook on cryptocurrency, both the technology and store value and all that stuff? Is it something that you see a bright future for, or what's your latest outlook?
So I view Bitcoin, for example, as an emergent store of value. So it's because of its volatility, it's kind of currently being in the process of finding its total addressable market. So it's a very volatile asset. So it's basically, technically, it is a store of value that can be self-custodied and basically held outside of the system, similar to gold. But because it's so volatile, it's more like it's an investment in the idea that it's becoming a store of value rather than one already, except for people that are really hardcore of it and kind of just completely ignore that volatility. And so basically, when I first analyzed the crypto space in detail back in 2017, I passed on it. It was late in that cycle. We had that really euphoric price action. It basically made it so there's a big enough asset that someone like me that looks at multiple asset classes, it basically became on my radar. But the combination of euphoric price action and the big dilution among all these different altcoins and everything really kind of put me off the space, and I passed on it. But in early 2020, I became bullish on Bitcoin because, you know, the biggest downside of cryptocurrencies is, unlike, say, fiat currencies, that they're mandated to be used by a government, and then you have precious metals, where there's only a handful of precious metals. You can't make more of them. You know, you can basically, they're each limited to how much we can extract from the earth. You can't just make a whole new precious metal to compete with the existing ones.
There's only so many elements on the periodic chart. Yeah,
exactly. And so the downside with cryptocurrencies is that anyone can make a new one, and that threatens the value proposition, even if each individual currency has some degree of you know, scarce monetary policy. And so really what it comes down to is whether or not one or two of them can develop a strong enough network effect where the, you know, that long tail of thousands of other currencies don't matter. Kind of like how if a certain technical protocol takes over, like the whole internet runs on, you know, TCP/IP, it doesn't matter if there's like copycats out there, because it's the network effect is so strong that this 50-year-old technology has become the foundation of the internet and is really kind of still going. And so the question is basically whether Bitcoin's network effect is sufficient enough to allow it to kind of, you know, keep capturing the majority of the market share in that space, or if just the deluge of competitors will chip away at it. And so basically what I do is I look at all the kind of the major currencies. I figure out what made Bitcoin successful other than first mover advantage and basically the path dependence. And overall, I am pretty bullish on Bitcoin as a, you know, kind of a portion of a portfolio that is adjusted for volatility and basically adjusted for someone's conviction in the asset class. And so, you know, there are people that go really hardcore and they put all their net worth in it or something like that. Whereas I take a step back and I say, within the grand scheme of portfolio, along with my equities, along with precious metals, I do like having a Bitcoin slice in there. And I think that so far it's improved the risk adjusted returns of the portfolio. And I am pretty optimistic on the technology, but my main risk analysis, or basically the thing I'm always critical on, is the network effect basically strong enough to kind of hold back all these competitors? So I'm basically, my case since early 2020 has been that probably, you know, non-zero is appropriate now. And that can mean different things for different people. Basically, I think that 1 or 2% at minimum makes sense for a lot of people once they understand it. And then of course, some people are very high conviction on it, and so they can dial it up. And so I think 5% is reasonable for someone who is, you know, pretty solidly bullish on it. Going up to, you know, 10% or more can make sense. But then once you get into really high levels, that's when you can have these big drawdowns that start affecting your overall portfolio. Another challenge that it's a really good problem to have, but another challenge that crypto investors have is that, say they bought Bitcoin as a 5% position.
You get a rebalance.
But then it went up dramatically, and it's kind of like, well, do you trigger all these capital gains, or do you let that portion run, or do you kind of keep that separate? And so that, you know, basically your starting position is not necessarily, you know, something you have to maintain all the time, but, you know, basically taking into account tax efficiencies, taking into account your conviction level, I think there's a pretty broad range of what percentages are reasonable. And just overall, my view is kind of, you know, basically have it as a slice.
Looking at the price action this year, these things have gone up so much, you know, do they need to correct further? The space has a long history of you know, 80%+ corrections. Do you have any concerns about excessive speculation in the prices of the cryptos at current levels?
So I did a couple months ago. I've been writing about that in my research service, where I was kind of separating the fact that I'm long-term still bullish on Bitcoin but that it increasingly became a less asymmetric trade than when I started kind of pounding the table in that position in early 2020. And so basically after you had that strong rise, I was kind of saying, I still don't think this bull market's over, but you know, when you start to get things like Dogecoin, being mentioned on Saturday Night Live, or like, yeah, basically Uber drivers kind of trading cryptos while they're driving people around, that's when the whole space gets really frothy. And so overall, the big correction we had, if you look at, for example, Bitcoin's price history, this 50% correction, puts it in the top six of all time Bitcoin corrections. And so it's at the point where a lot of the froth has been removed. The consensus is pretty bearish on it now, especially for people that are outside of the crypto space that are looking in on it. They look at that chart and they say that's bearish and it's going lower. And so overall, I don't have a strong case about what it's going to do in a quarter or two. But overall, I do think that it's not a bad time to, if someone feel like they missed out on previous price action, to then look at the current weakness and say, maybe the top, Bitcoin or maybe the top two, and say, I want to have a small slice at that current time. And overall, one of my main kind of focuses on price, basically forecasting in the loose sense, is I look at some of the things that are happening on chain. So are long-term holders selling or buying, basically who's buying, who's selling. Basically, you can kind of analyze, but that's kind of the interesting thing about the blockchain, is that you have these ways to look at it and analyze the data and see, what type of our exchanges, is more coins coming to exchanges or leaving exchanges? Is basically short-term traders that sold, and we're basically, there's kind of different groups you can monitor to see how they're behaving. Another thing you can do is look at demand, the big demand drivers. And so for a couple quarters, part of that big price increase was that you had a lot of grayscale buying. So the big grayscale Bitcoin trust, and part of that was natural buying, but another big chunk of that was arbitrage traders, where they would buy GBTC, but then they were short Bitcoin, and they basically would extract that premium that grayscale has over Bitcoin. But because that premium turned into a discount due to increased competition from other types of funds, that neutral trade pretty much went away. And I think that had a lot to do with this big kind of price correction that we've had in the space. It basically set the stage for some of these other more temporary factors like Elon's comments and things like that to drive down the price. And so I think that the key to look out for next is to see what are the next sources of demand. And I think overall, one of them might, for example, be Bitcoin rewards cards. You see, for example, companies like Fold or BlockFi are issuing these cards where you basically every purchase you get more Bitcoin. And then you have a company like NYDIG that's partnering with banks to have Bitcoin rewards cards. And so, if you kind of see that starting to take off, that's another, potential leg up for demand. And so I just kind of keep monitoring the space and look for setbacks or advancements in the network effect of Bitcoin and some of the other protocols.